satisfied themselves. They lost their school. So, we're going on 10 years now. And as Mitch pointed out at a recent meeting, our equipment's gone on 10 years old. Hard drives, he thinks that's ancient in technological terms. The scanner we were using is also going on 10, and it's starting to show some signs of age. So, recently we formed a 501c3 so that we can receive donations that are tax-free to the donors, so we can hopefully acquire the funds to update that. We want to continue the project for the next decade as well. And I want to say one other thing, the scanners are going on 10 years old. People actually do it. And on a couple of occasions, we've had some grants and we were able to borrow some stipends, and on other times, we've been using strictly volunteers. It works much easier if you can offer a stipend to people than if you can assure yourself that the people will show up and continue to be there the next election. So anyhow, with the 501c3, we will be able to do that. Other than that, Carolyn is no longer our registrar. She retired 2 years ago. Kelly Sanders, who replaced her, is has worked as a general election manager since Lindsay then, not long after the first of the paper. So she's strongly on board, both on the 501c3's board of directors. And most recently, Mitch, who most of this decade was semi-employed, he's been fully employed the last year and a half. And he just doesn't have the time to continue at the rate he was. So he wants to step back after November. But he also brought to our last meeting a fellow who was a retired election computer program, also versed in open source. And having met him, he's very interested in open and honest elections. So we're hopeful that that will be a seamless transition going forward. I think that's it. There's no questions at this point. Okay. There you go.
Kevin very well will be sticking around for questions. I've also been asked if people are involved in extended conversations to talk outside, because not everyone has a loud booming voice like myself. And again, Lori Grace involved in financing the track and burn in the open source. She tried to bring it to Ohio, but the Board of Elections referred to it as snitchware. All right. Questions for Derek or Kevin?
Here, Kelly Mordecai. Kevin, you and I talked several months ago. I was so excited when I heard about your Transparency Project. I got your name from the county clerk when I was calling around looking at some things Humboldt. And I think you guys got the highest in the North today for Bernie Sanders. It was like, I think, 33 points. For Bernie, it was Humboldt, Trinity, Shasta, and Sister County's all Hillary got cream there. But the highest I could just say by the top of my head, look, oh, it's a Transparency Project. You don't dare cheat there. Okay? So very many, many congratulations there. I did want to ask you. Yeah, I just wanted to ask you, I mean, where are the man hours involved? I mean, team 510, go ahead.
Well, okay, we see ourselves as two things. Hopefully a model, and also the laboratory. So, just quite a few man hours is taking us. We use two persons at a time, never have anybody in the room alone. One person usually in the chain of custody, one operating the scanner and the computer interface. And so two people, we're able to process anywhere about $1,000 per hour. On a recent election where there was just a single-sided short ballot, really, so two papers that we're going to have in November that are legal size and go slower. And then hopefully it will be more than 1,000 per hour. But we were able to do this last primary election probably in about 2 weeks of scanning 6 hours a day. And if we can get a second jujitsu. We probably might use one. We could then have a backup in case the first one starts to fail. And we could also, if they're both working, do it faster. So I think it's scalable. I think it could be used in other jurisdictions. So so that's, we could talk more about it later and give you more detail.
Yeah. So you do have a counter so you know the number of ballots that the scanner has.
Yeah, well, see, as I said, the pre-imprinter puts a unique number, so it starts at, say, 1 and ends up at the final ballot. So we know, as we did, it was one vote in November, June primary in 2008, and there are 197 more people, just based on the count.
So you're saying the number gets put on the edge?
On the edge of the ballot as it goes through. And then it can be seen by the person who's looking at it, and we can go back and find those ballots. So like 197 went missing, we could look at the images, see, she could go find the paper.
Nice. Yeah. So this is in the clerk's office in all of your machine?
No, it's in the election division.
Election division. So yeah. Obviously it's in the government, government building. I mean, it's, hi, how you doing? So how did the public react towards the...
The public's been tremendously supportive. It's glorious. I mean, Carolyn's a hero of the project. We received awards from the ACLU, from Civil Liberties Monitoring Project group that she announced it at back in 2005. Editorials are good. People trust the system. That's why they're not having a recounts.
Are you having high voter turnout? Do you believe that the voter turnout is increasing?
I can't say that. Actually, I think that due to the general trend in the society, I think several of our last elections has increased.
Hi, Derek. It's good to see you again. I'm glad you're working on that. Thank you. Ken, right?
Yeah.
Kevin, it's nice to meet you because I've heard so much about the project and I've never been able to really visualize it. Slowly I'm getting there. I know I'm from Los Angeles, so I was on the, Voter Systems Advisory Project, helping to advise what kind of system, paper ballot was my non-negotiable. I think they told me that they have talked to Mitch about using ballot images as a transparency aspect in the vote counting process of what will be a selections-only paper ballot. I only know the vote casting part so far. The vote counting part I know is still being negotiated and talked about. Do you have any, now there's 4 million voters, a selections-only ballot, meaning it's only printing out, Bob Fitrakis for governor, yes, so, do you know, A, if such a discussion is taking place, and B, do you think that it is scalable to a 4 million ballot jurisdiction?
Well, really, if they talk to Mitch, we need to talk to Mitch. I didn't hear about that.
Okay.
But his program is based on, it does use some optical character recognition, but that seems to be the weakest link of it, because OCIs, but then he correlates where the bubbles are filled in with the names that are designated on the ballots. And so I know it works well, can work well, with paper ballots and the voter is possible. With bubble losers, whoever's probably lines or anything like that. And, it really would come down to the OCR. And I think, you could work personally. You'd have to talk to somebody.
So great that you've had a good relationship with your registrar of voters, unlike our experience.
It sounds like yours is different. I know that there was one point where Mitch went down to, this was many years ago, tried to run it on an fall election in Mendocino. It may have been the same registrar. You're still too old, aren't you?
Yes.
Yeah. He had the wrong equipment. He brought a scanner that was something other than the one we had, and it, his results were kind of mixed. But sure, and then you know who you have in your county right now? Scott Menzies is running. I don't know if you're on the coast or on the inland.
We're inland.
Okay, well, Scott's running for city council in Fort Bragg, and he worked with us when he was in Humboldt County. So he'd be a good one to talk to as well.
So I think we have a specific question.
Yeah, thank you. We'll have a lot of specific questions for you, but in general, a lot of this falls into the category of processing like provisional ballots, because it sounds like you're scanning in the same ballots that are counted by the tabulators. By the time our processed provisional ballots got to the tabulating machines, a good number of them had already been thrown out. So that's our registrar told us that she threw them out. I don't know exactly what that means. There also was whiteout on a number of things like that. So, right, so I'm wondering how, you know, if somebody's able to see their ballot.
Okay, what the process there, and that I think is statewide, is that before the ballot's provisional, they have to investigate it. They have to see if you didn't vote by mail, and then vote at the polling place, or those sort of things. And if the ballot is adjudicated such that it's not included in the original count through D-rolls, according to the state certified equipment, then it doesn't run through.
Hi, Kevin.
Hey, Lori. So,
Kevin, you know, as you know, we helped you with some of the financing of some of the areas that are running the track and field system. Or maybe you don't know yet.
Well, no, I know that Mitch worked with you guys.
We worked in Humboldt and NOAA.
Right, and then, yeah, no, and we were very grateful you gave us a
grant. And we still had more money. And I had talked with Carl Carter about helping to get it started now again. And management also was feeling discouraged at that point because the Mendocino people wouldn't even ask for his results at that point. They were always too busy. So I think perhaps the political system has changed. And it's, I think I heard you say that Mitch is still not directly involved.
No, Mitch did at our last meeting. He said he'd like to step back, not completely away. He's on our board of directors. But he just doesn't have time. And so hopefully Wes Rishel, I think is his fellow's name, is his, the fellow he thinks is, would be a good fit to continue doing what he's doing. So,
I want to say that I and Carl Carter, who's part of the Voters' Rights Task Force, would be happy to engage with him.
Okay, well, we'd love to talk.
So I can get your details later.
Sure.
Okay? And what really inspired me about all this, and how I knew, you know, that this was coming out of a citizens' initiative, and then also having a registrar who is championing this. I haven't had a chance to talk to Kelly yet, but I'm really happy. I heard she's excited about it or happy about it. But I'd like to involve more, so I just want to get that.
Well, I'll pass it on. She's in Hawaii right now, so.
That's Carolyn.
Carolyn.
No, I'm talking about Kelly.
Oh, Kelly. No, 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 absolutely. No, she, like I said, she's busy.
Right now,
because the election's coming. I know that she would wanted to come down, but she just feels
when
like
she's... When you tried to get it into tech CEIC, you know, the CAFO thing, I don't know how people say it, you know, for the election clerks and supervisors and registrars. But I know Carol didn't have a chance to get through, but maybe with all this focus on hacking and other things, we'll be able to make a difference now.
Yeah.
And when I did look up the voter participation rates percentage-wise, a few years ago when I was working with you, I do want to say yours was among the top in California.
Oh, good.
in Humboldt.
Right, and I think that's still maybe true, but I understood the question to be, are they going up? And I'd say that, but compared to others, yes.
It was way up there.
Good. Thank you.
You ran for Secretary of State before, and I'm wondering if you would do it again. I never realized how important it is.
Down the state who care deeply about our elections and our process. And I think I did as much to advance a lot of these issues as I had in my other, you know, nonpartisan advocacy hat. So, I certainly have not ruled out ever doing it again because I feel like it was a very worthwhile thing. I don't think anybody's made any decisions about how things will go next time, so I don't have an answer for you other than, you know, we'll see.
Common cause and move to amend, and also these community bill of rights that seem to be inundating the Midwest. How should we look at that?
Well, what I think you're getting at is there are many different facets to the Citizens United ruling, some of them on the corporate personhood piece, and there are facets of that that have nothing to do with campaign finance. You go way back to 1886 and Santa Clara County case and consumer issues and whatnot, and some folks are more focused on that. And then there are obviously the money politics pieces, which in some ways have gotten more of the press and visibility than what they campaign finance case. You have traditional good government groups like Common Cause and Public Citizen and others like that who put more energy and focus into what they know is money and politics. More grassroots groups move to event groups that are putting more energy into the corporate personhood thing. I think it is, you know, all of the above, and it's wonderful to have people focusing on what they're most passionate about, and I think it all builds and adds to it. So people should check out all the groups. There are dozens of them working in this space, and find one that fits your passion and roll up your sleeves and dig in.
All right, thanks. Okay, Luci Riley.
Disastrous. It was that day that actually precipitated our formation
And so we pulled together, several of us, had a great social media angle that could send out memes in a moment, round up hundreds or thousands of people to folks in a particular direction. And that was a really important part of it, was being able to pull the average person off the net and get them activated into taking out, doing something. In the end, it was doing things like giving people notice that they should check their voter registration before the election, after the election, and let us know if they had problems. So things of that nature. And it was all about bringing lawsuits in the end. If you remember, well, she'll be talking in a minute. But so we started out in Arizona, in the primary there, ended up helping John Brady get his suit off the ground. And as we were doing that, people realized that in New York, the same thing was happening there, that things like people's voter registrations were being changed. They were being knocked off the rolls or made inactive. And so at that point, we realized that we needed to litigate in New York as well. And that's when we set up our Facebook page and website to point to a voter complaint form. So we had people in New York, it was ended up being like 750 people came to our voter complaint form with the understanding that that they would be making a statement that could be used in a lawsuit to press for their rights in court. So, you know, people knew that they should be careful in what they say and tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Let's see. And so that was great in New York, but on the way to California, that's when things really congealed, and we came together with the folks that eventually made Ballots for Bernie, the great people who were running this show. And so I guess that's a good start.
That's a great start. Thank you. So while I'm introducing myself, I would like to invite all of my Ballots for Bernie volunteers that have helped put this conference together. Folks, come on up. We've got people from all over the state here. Thank you so much. Voice cracks, it's because I mean it from the bottom of my heart. I thank you guys so much. We've been through so much together. We've gotten burning blisters on our feet. We've gotten bruises on our knuckles. We worked so hard to get our candidate in office. And we didn't stop June 7th. We went right to work on a ballot count observation task force monitoring this ballot count to make sure that our candidate got every ballot counted as cast. And I want to thank you for what you've done, for not only for Bernie, but for ourselves. We've done so much for ourselves in this movement, because one thing that we realized is that we didn't join Bernie's campaign. He joined our movement. Yeah. And we're going to take that movement forward. And I want you guys to stand behind me, because I want our folks on the live stream to understand something. When you see me talking to you on Sunday afternoons from 5 to 6 o'clock, we're late. We're fashionably late quite often, getting our AV equipment together. We appreciate you following what we're doing on Sundays. We appreciate you being part of the formula of educate, agitate, demonstrate, and legislate. We appreciate you coming in and educating yourselves on what these issues mean to you as a voter. Our precious right to vote is the most precious right we have as American citizens. In this Democratic primary, we saw 9% of registered Democrats come out to vote. That's an abysmal number of people who trust the process. These people that are standing behind me today, folks, want to be part of changing that process. We are election integrity activists. We may be new to the process, but we are old soldiers in fighting the fight. We have been fighting for our issues, some of us for decades. I'm proud of this gray hair. There you go. Thank you, Summer. We want to invite you. The 3,600 people that are following us online right now, we want to invite you, do not fall to the wayside after the general election. Do not think that you cannot be part of a process that is going to move voter trust forward, because that's what it's about, folks. We want to do the work with our county ROVs, with our state houses. We want to take this election integrity movement all the way to Washington, folks. And we've got to elect our candidates right here to do it. And lead us on that. That's what we're going to do. Because nobody can do this alone. And the reason that I had my team up here standing behind me is because I really want to get the message to you at home, no matter where you are. You can tell by the southern accent that I didn't come from California. I grew up in Jackson, Mississippi. So being part of the first election since the Voting Rights Act has been gutted resonates loudly for me. It resonates loudly with the million people across the Deep South that voted for a self-declared democratic socialist 74-year-old wild-haired Jew. We're ready. We're ready. 72% of millennials who came out to vote, and we know we got to do some encouraging to get you out to vote, millennials. We love you. We need you to come out to vote. 72% of millennials who came out to vote in the Democratic primary, again, voted for a self-declared democratic socialist. The progressive movement of America has arrived. We're here. So I want to talk a little bit about what we did with Ballots for Bernie. We had 58 grassroots groups across the state of California for 58 counties organized, and all these people back here helped me do it, plus hundreds of people all over the state of California. We organized ballot count observation monitoring teams in 2 weeks, people. 2 weeks. We used the greatest political organizing tool that we've been able to wrap our opposable thumbs around since we climbed down out of the trees, folks. We used social media to evolve the process of political grassroots activism. It's how we ran Bernie Sanders' campaign. It's how many of these people standing behind me talked with each other for months, some of us a year, online before we ever shook each other's hand or hugged each other. Yeah. This is how we do it. This conference today, as much great information as we've gotten, and what do you guys think about the conference? Have you got some great information? Without streams that we're doing. And thank you, Summer, for helping us out. And I want us to give a shout out to all of Summer's folks that are following her at home. Without these live streams, we would not be able to share this great work that we're doing right now with people across the country and the planet. And everybody's watching what's happening in the wealthiest country in the world that puts out $600 billion a year for the U.S. war machine. Everybody's watching. We've got important work to do, and it starts with the election integrity movement in America. Folks watching us at home, we want to invite you to join us. No matter where you are across the country, if you're in Paul's neck of the woods, you can join in with Election Justice USA. Paul's going to tell you a little bit more about his website and his Facebook page, because we want to get you involved, okay? Ballotsforbernie.org. We used to be just a California organization. Today, we are announcing that we're opening up to your request to join our private page from all over the country. When we started this process, I was an admin for the Ballots for Bernie page. And my good buddy, I call her my comrade, Lauren Steiner, down in LA, called me up after we had already started talking about monitoring our ballot count. And she said, "Luci, we've got to get on this process." And I said, "Lauren, catch up." Lauren oversaw LA County. That was a big job. If Lauren could be here today, she would be up here with this group. She helped us immensely. She organized conference calls all over the state. And Lauren, if you're watching, and I know you are, I want to thank you, honey. Comrade, this takes all of us. This takes all of us. You can follow Lauren on Our Revolution in LA. You can follow what she's doing down there, and she's doing some great work. So what we did with Ballots for Bernie is we organized a Facebook page. And Eric, I want you to wave your hand, honey. Eric, there he is. Eric is our tech guru. Eric is our tech guru. We wish you all the best. Eric helped us build a website called BallotsForBernie.org. We had people send a request to join BallotsForBernie.org. We were able to take their contact information, put them in contact with a county team lead that we had organized on our Ballots for Bernie Facebook page. We were able to put teams all over the ground in 2 weeks because we used this social media tool. Eric was very instrumental in calling a lot of these county team leads and walking them through some dark moments, giving them a cyber pat on the back. And we appreciate that. We could not have done this with just one person. This took a small army of people. And folks at home, I want you to understand that I may be the name and face of Ballots for Bernie, but I'm just the mouthpiece of all these hardworking people behind me. I was the number one seated delegate for Bernie for CD11, and my friend Eric was one of our male delegates. We went to Philadelphia. We took the message of Ballots for Bernie with us to Philadelphia. I talked to every delegate that I could bend their ear about what we were doing with election integrity in California and invited them to join me. Part of what we're doing with the process of an election integrity movement is not only educating ourselves about what the problems are, we are also agitating people that are angry about this election, because there's a whole lot of people whose eyes have been opened, whose minds have been busted wide open, and they know there's a problem and they want to do something about it. That is the first step of activism. Anger has two sides, right? Passion and resentment. And all too easy, We can fall into resentment when we've gone through a process like this primary election and we feel cheated. We can't move the ball forward unless we flip that quarter around to heads, which is passion about doing something. Many hands make light work. One person cannot do it alone. This takes an army. What we're doing with Ballots for Bernie on the local level is all these folks that you see behind me are also going to Joe Pantamita's office, right? And we're going to the RMV's office in Alameda County as well. And we are making steps forward to create a relationship. I'm from the South, so I like to say we attract more flies with honey than we do with vinegar. So we're angry about the process of what's happened. And it's hard to put a smile on our faces and go forward and create these relationships, but we know that that is exactly what we have to do. As voters, as tax-paying citizens, we have the right to be part of the process, and we are inviting everyone who's watching on the live stream, everyone that's here today, that what we want you to do is to join your election integrity activist group where you are. If you don't have one, come to Ballots for Bernie. We will hook you up, baby. We will hook you up. We are connected with folks all over the state of California, and we hope that by the next time we have this annual conference, we will have members for Ballots for Bernie all over the country. We want you to go to your ROV's office. We want you to go to your Board of Supervisors meetings. We want you to complain about what happened in the primary where you live. We want you to talk with your ROV's office about how you can be part of the process of changing the elections in your county, because we have to think globally but act locally. We've got to do it at the county level. We can complain all day long about Washington. Washington has never done anything without a grassroots groundswell. Folks, we want to invite you to be part of that. Thank you so much for coming out to the conference today. And folks on the live stream, thank you so much for joining us on the live stream. We want to get those numbers up to 5,000. Share these live streams with your friends. And if you got an extra $5 to send us, go find fundme.com/takebackthevote. We can use a little extra cash to help us cover our expenses. Nobody does this alone. This takes an army. Thank you so much for being a part of this today. And if anyone has any questions for Paul and I, we'll take those now. Thank you, folks.
This is an official passport. There's only two in the world like this, official. Now, I should know, Richard, but you know that this passport is not valid for travel to or for communist-controlled portions of Korea, Vietnam. You know what's coming? Perfect. Or to or in Albania or Disney World. And I'll just be real quick. I said, this is an official passport. What do you say, Jim? To pick you up, I don't need an official passport. This passport has been signed by the Secretary of State of California, Deborah Bowie. There's only two of them in the world. Richard, I hope that you very much. Thank you for all the work you've been doing.
They also sent us lots of angry, disappointed, and depressed Californians who wanted to register their votes, their complaints with us, which they did. And so we ended up with, you gave us like 850 different voter complaints for adding to our lawsuits in California. And that's a real powerful voice.
That's how we work together.
Yes, still beautiful. In any event, I need to advocate for Election Justice USA's website because that's where we hope in the future you'll be coming and doing our activation effort. And that's electionjusticeusa.org. And our Facebook page is facebook.com/electionjusticeusa. We also use Twitter, which is the @ elect justice, elect_justice. And then after having been getting censored a lot on Facebook, we've also recently started migrating or at least co-operating on a page called MeWe.com. And there's a lot less tracking there, no censorship so far. People are coming. So if you go to MeWe.com/electionjusticeusa, it's MeWe.com. It's very short. I don't know how they got that in this day and age. Okay. And let's see. So what these guys did was sent us 800 people, 800 complaints, and out of what came out of that and the rest of the nation's effort at bringing us into informed state regarding what was going on in the country. The Democracy Lost report came out of that. And there's just, as you can tell, there's 100 pages there. We put together quite a lot of material with the help of, I think we acknowledged 10 different people that were the authors of channel material that you guys gave us into that effort. So, let's see, anything else? Oh, yes. The one thing I wanted to end up with in my statement here was something that I hope would bring some hope into your going forward the rest of this election season. So I wanted to talk about A, there are things you can do. One of the things we're doing is advocating for hand-counted paper ballots because now's the time to do that. After the election, we know a lot of people tend to fade away. So whether it's going to happen in time for November or not, obviously, it's unlikely, but if you get your county and your neighbors and your board of elections knowledgeable, it could happen in some places soon. we'll be posting a template that came from Virginia Martin in Columbia County, New York, who's worked with us to do a live stream on how to do the hand counted paper ballots effort. So that's point one. Point two, I wanted to report some new information out of the Florida race between Deputy Wasserman Schultz and Canova. If you've seen our other report, this is the Democracy Lost 100 pager. We have another report called An Electoral System in Crisis by Lulu Freestadt, our associate journalist, collaborator, and Fritz Schuring. In that report, there were basically, it's based on the CBT chart system, which plots from smallest to largest on the x-axis, the precincts and the votes that are associated with those precincts. As you plot that, you plot the percentage that each candidate gets in that. Hillary, say, maybe got 60%, some people say, and Bernie got 40%. In a hand-counted paper ballot or scanned ballot system, you would see two lines that run parallel as you go across that chart. In machine-counted counties and sectors where most of the cases we looked at, Bernie versus Hillary, you would see chart lines that would diverge or even cross over, and that's a sign of tampering. Oh, yes. Well, there's actually, you can go further down. So that's an indication. When you do the hand counting versus the machine counting, the hand counting tends to favor Bernie in New York, and those cases that we were able to do that. So let's see. Do you have further down the page? Do you have further down the page the charts that go like that?
I'll go find it.
Oh, okay. No, no. If you can find one example from electoral system and prices, that would be good. In any event, so we get these non-crazy straight lines of hand-counted precincts counties. We get these crazy scissor form or crossover, and what it does is shows that as you get to go to larger and larger precincts, larger and larger vote counts in those big precincts, that in this case, nothing changes. Each succeeding count is the same, represents the same population as the previous one did. But as you go in those machine counted sections, you see that divergence. So as the district gets larger, Hillary would get more votes and Bernie would get less. And so that's a pretty important fact to take away. So the point I'm bringing, I had to give that little intro because we see similarly in the Wasserman Schultz versus Canova race, that as Wasserman Schultz numbers went up, Canova's went down, and you get that sort of divergent lines. So we'll be putting up a report on our blog tonight. We actually are going to start blogging. It'll be on electionjustice.net. So to me, that's kind of helpful because it draws the focus of attention back to the people who many people think rigged the election or whatever, manipulated at least. And that's the DNC. So anyhow, the third point I wanted to make was regarding a collaboration, and I hope he came back in. Oh, yes, he did. It's a collaboration between Election Justice USA and one of the votes, Kelly Mordecai, and he's got his patriotic shirt on. And it's to use, particularly in California, because there was massive manipulation or what have you here. The election problems here. But he has developed, what's the name of the book?
The Hidden Fourth Branch, Corrupt Government's Worst Nightmare. And you can submit a petition or a complaint to your civil grand jury here in California or working on a national plan. I did want to validate, well, we did this last night, but what's exciting about what Paul did in Election Justice, they did an online declaration drive. You know, whatever problem you were experiencing, you can go to Election Justice, check the box, add comments. Well, similarly and separately, we didn't even know each other a few months ago, but Watch the Vote did the same thing, parallel effort, and we got the same results. And so, we're sharing information. So what I'm doing is testifying as a second witness that what Election Justice did, we also did, found the same results. So, Of course we're not crazy. We have evidence.
No, you're not crazy.
It's not a conspiracy theory. So I want to bring Kelly into the mix because of the civil grand jury approach, I believe, in California is going to be a way to bring investigative and authority to look into what happened in elections in 58 counties. In every county, there's a civil grand jury that's seated that will take complaints from the citizens. Or if you have evidence from within the county, which we have 850 different Californians, and Watch the Vote has another 100 or so. 100, yeah. So we've got lots of complaint material to start with. I think we could blanket, they cover 25 counties, our data covers 45, so we could cover all 58 counties and try to prompt investigations. So my point there is I'm hoping that's gonna be a hopeful thing for you all. And if you can join in, we'll be happy to collaborate. So let's see. Last point then, to do that sort of thing, we also need funding. So if you could send $5, $10, or...
No donation is too small.
What she said. To paypal.me/electionjusticeUSA. That would be a wonderful thing. And I guess that's it for now. We'll take questions.
Thank you, Steve. All good things come to those who wait. I wanted to thank you so much for that presentation and for your passionate call to action. My name is Alice Chan. I'm from Sonoma County. And as I said earlier today, I have been monitoring elections for 10 years. So that predates the passion for Bernie. I've just always been an election nerd. And partially thanks to Progressive Democrats of America, the very first time I monitored an election was because I was with PDA. Thank you so much, Judy, and Amy. But what I wanted to share with you is actually using that passion, some nuts and bolts things that are best practices for when you're getting started to go to a registrar of voters for the first time, or even if it's for the second time. The first thing I always do is ask for the most recent copy of the Registrar of Voters official canvas procedures. And I read it carefully, and then I look for any other documents that are referenced in that procedure. It's usually 9 to 12 pages long. And I ask for copies of those documents. And then I go to the most recent version of the California Elections Code and compare what I see in the procedures with what is actually in the code. This is extremely important because it gives you a chance to compare what they're doing with what they're supposed to be doing. And then if I have previous experience observing an election, I can take my previous memories, compare it with what I'm seeing in their current procedures, see if I remember that they were doing that before. I have kept copious notes during all this time. I've organized volunteers who have given me handwritten reports of what they've seen and what they haven't seen. After each monitoring process, we do sort of an after-action report, what we saw, what we didn't see, what we liked, what we didn't like, what we intend to talk to the registrar about in the future. If there's something that's important enough that it needs to go be escalated to a higher authority to get corrected. These procedures are something that everyone should be using in order to get the most out of the observation. If you know what it is you're going to be looking for ahead of time, then you'll know when you're not seeing what you're supposed to be seeing. Thanks. Was there a question? No? Oh.
Thank you for that compliment, and thank you, Luci, for your incredible answer. And Paul, I feel Paul's gratitude. He invited me out to a meeting to talk a little about legal questions in Philadelphia, and you didn't have to talk much to the election justice people. They already knew it all, that something was wrong with the election. So Paul's been active, you know, for well over a decade now, and I appreciate all your work. And, you know, the ballot, I hope the Bernie for the ballots and all that goes worldwide, extraterrestrial, because it's a great organization.
Thank you.
stand up.
By this group, we didn't really know about Progressive Democrats of America, when nobody really wanted to listen to us at the time they invited us in. And also, I got to speak at their gathering, even though I'm in another minor party. She has never, ever discriminated. She has never wavered on this issue. And the realities of what happens in Ohio, I'm well aware that it's Progressive Democrats under the green label that are in counties throughout the state. It's not all the Greens. The vast majority of people are those that look to Mimi Kennedy for leadership. Thank you, Mimi.
Thank you, Bob. Political bigotry is not an organizing principle, I'll tell you that. Well, I was asked to talk about federal legislation. Federal legislation, the frosting on the cake or the banana peel on the sidewalk. Yeah. Representative Hank Johnson, who is from Georgia. Georgia, an all paperless DRE state where there are no audits whatsoever. Representative Hank Johnson has introduced two bills this session. They probably won't even get to the floor, but the point is to have drafted some legal language to get us out of the trouble that all the legislators and the political parties now know we are in and are trying to blame the Russians. Probably so we can have a war instead of solve our election problems. But we're gonna go right past that. No, right past that, we're not gonna do that. This way. So the Help America Vote Act was election reform, therefore I'm allergic to federal election reform. But I have read these bills on your behalf. I thought I was going to talk about LA, which I know like the back of my hand, but the federal election legislation is a bit of a different thing, and the devil is always in the details. So when I heard that this was a revision of the Help America Vote Act, using much of the Rush-Holt bill, there were already 15 red flags, but also some good things too. So I thought, what does this do? Some time back, our community was divided by the Rush-Holt election reform bill because we wanted it to ban direct record electronic machines outright. If that was going to be a reform, then number one, no more buying, making of direct record electronic tabulating with or without a paper. And they couldn't do it. There wasn't the political space to do that. So many of us opposed the Rush-Holt bill. And I have friends who say, you know, if you hadn't opposed that, we wouldn't be in this trouble now. And I think they're probably right. But I also think we were right to oppose it for that reason, not to proliferate DREs. So, what does this bill say? H.R. 6072. Two very nice ages, one I've passed and one I am still getting towards. And this is called the Election Integrity Act of 2016. All right, well, now, what does it say? It is to promote the accuracy, integrity, and security through the voter-verified permanent paper ballot. All right, I already like that. And by the way, it's not like I'm an innocent coming to this and didn't know it was happening. John Lewis,
who the great voting rights hero, has introduced reform legislation every session that the Republicans won't let to the floor. And I was instrumental, I'm sure I'm not the only one, but my contact with Lewis's office, I would go paper ballot, paper ballot, paper ballot, like ain't gonna be no election integrity community support unless it's a paper ballot. No, not a paper record, paper ballot, legal ballot and record. So that's first step. Here, all right, Hank Johnson, we like it. And by the way, I have been told, and Bev Harris has known this all along, the voter suppression, the movement to end voter suppression has finally combined with the movement to end election fraud. Because people understand that all election reform is whack-a-mole. And the minute you get one down, the other one pops up. And our job, when we finally have enough people to do it, thank you, Ballots for Bernie. Luci, you're amazing. Jim Sober brought me here. I want to thank you. I want to thank everybody whose names I don't know. But because it's a movement, it's gotten so big, that's now a good thing. I just want to thank you. But now we begin to have enough people to play whack-a-mole completely effectively and win, which is exciting. All right, so there is, first up, a moratorium on the acquisition of certain direct record electronic voting systems and certain other voting systems. Well, what does that mean? That means if this is passed, nobody can purchase a DRE anymore without a paper record. Well, I don't even want to purchase one with the paper record because that paper record is not enough. And that is one thing I'm talking about in Johnson's office. We got to make sure this language is all paper ballot. In a couple of places it says paper record. I think that's to grandfather in. Somebody still has stuff and doesn't have enough money to go and develop new stuff until what this bill does, which is it appropriates $5 million to give to at least three entities, in order to develop open source, transparent, paper ballot-based voting systems. And once they have the software and the thing that they've developed with the software that is a paper ballot-based voting system, hand-countable paper ballot, presumably it'll be scanned, but redundantly hand-counted if we want it, we got enough people, whatever. That is what this does. And once it's developed by these entities, it's free. It's free to any county who wants to have that system. Paper ballot, open source. So, you know, I'm liking this bill on paper, and as we know, what else happens? Okay, there are additional voting requirements. I want to give some shout out to some people that are our heroes because I keep putting in, there are these provisions. I call this the Palast provision. Any paper ballot, which is cast by an individual under this clause. And this clause says, if you've got voting machines in your precinct, you also have to have emergency paper ballots. Absolutely, no outs. You have to have pre-printed paper ballots for that precinct that people can use. They don't want to stand in line forever to use a machine for any reason. They get to use that paper ballot. And it says here, shall be counted and otherwise treated as a regular ballot for all purposes and not as a provisional ballot. Boom, bam, federal law. I like that. You know, and we're always told our provisional ballots are counted in Los Angeles County as long as no absentee ballot has arrived in that voter's name, something I want to address in a minute. So I always told Greg Palast, well, they're counted in LA. And he goes, well, they're not counted elsewhere. And sure enough, they're not. So these emergency ballots do not get to be categorized as provisional. The John Brakey, Jim March, Bev Harris effect. This is who can look at the disclosure of election dedicated voting system technology. You can look at it if you're a party to litigation, if you're an expert for a party to such litigation, if you're a person not described as such, but you're conducting academic, scientific, technological, or other investigation or inquiry concerning the adversary integrity of the technology. Great. Also, these non-disclosure agreements that somebody might make you sign to look at the voting technology, well, you're exempted from coverage because you got the information and you lawfully obtained it from another source or any information in the public domain. Bev Harris found Rob Georgia file, which contained Diebold's source code, on the internet, just sitting there, and she looked at it. And so she would be exempt. Also, Benny Smith, who found Fraction Magic, was looking at 7,000 documents obtained in a settlement of a lawsuit. People didn't want it to go any further, so they settled and went, here, 7,000 documents, you can have them. They were all encrypted. So it was like, good luck, you'll never find it. They got them unencrypted, and they found Fraction Magic. They'd be exempt. Okay. David Jefferson provision, no internet, no system or device upon which ballots are programmed or votes are cast or tabulated shall be connected to the internet at any time. So no email voting, no, right here. The San Diego effect, no sleepovers. The Judy Alter effect, blank ballots and completed ballots. There has to be a chain of custody, a written chain of custody posted from the elections official as to how this stuff is being handled. Hello, federal law. Now, it goes on. You need to be able to see the poll tapes. The Bob Fitrakis effect, I love this one. After the appropriate election official has certified the election, dedicated another voting system software for use of election, the manufacturer may not insert or use in the voting system any software patch, or other software modification. I don't know, Bob, if you're still with us, but you went to get that and say, you can't use this patch, and you finally found a judge who went, yeah, I agree with you. Well, I'm sorry, federal law, boom, bam, you're criminal. Criminal! Okay, it goes on and on. You have to keep the ballots for a long time. You can't destroy the ballots. Another Boston and Fitrakis provision. They finally won their lawsuit and said, show us paper ballots. And I don't know if we destroyed them. No. You don't do that. You have to get the raw precinct numbers, the Francois Choquette provision. Let me, the John Simon provision. Let me look at the raw numbers from the precinct. Well, federal law, you have to post them now. In terms of purging, there's a lot about observers, and it's good for us too. The purging rules, they have to post for 60 days and notify people that it is posted, names of people who are about to be purged. And they have to stay there for 60 days and they have to like let everybody know. Well, right now it's like a postcard that comes to your house that you throw out because you think it's some kind of stupid. Most of what we get is I'm selling you something and we just ignore it. So the elections offices have to stop going, we sent you a postcard, we relied on the mail. No, you have to advertise it. You have to get it out there on the radio so people can tell each other, didn't you hear about that thing? Go look and see if you're gonna be purged. And it says that it is mandatory, there is an enforcement mechanism, you get to challenge it, and H.R. 6072. Suffice to say, the text is on the internet, and you may go and read it. H.R. 6073, you've heard about. The Department of Homeland Security declares our elections infrastructure to be critical infrastructure. And as you've heard from, I think, Barbara and others, we've been saying this all along. Why isn't this critical infrastructure? Now, it's a little nerve-wracking to think of the Department of Homeland Security in charge of our elections. Like, game over, maybe. So I was asked by a young fellow who knew of my work, well, we're going to have a hearing on this, Ted News assistant. What should we ask? And I said, here's my question. Los Angeles County is going to have a publicly owned system. It's publicly owned, it's open source software, it creates a paper ballot. There is a 9-minute video of me using the vote casting portion of it as a prototype. The vote counting portion of it, as you've heard me ask questions about today, whether it's an infrared scanner of a QR embedded with the thing, or if we can get optical character recognition, we don't know yet. However, we own it. So if an election goes bad, it's like the police force being sued for brutality, right? It's the city of Los Angeles, it's the taxpayers on the line to pay the lawyers, to go on and on with the lawsuit, to have a botched election. We own it, we're in charge. Of course, we just say it's the election officials' fault, fire them, but bottom line, the people own it. So, if the Department of Homeland Security came and said, this is critical infrastructure, we have to do something about that, I said, who supersedes who? The people of the County of Los Angeles or the Department of Homeland Security? That is my basic question, and it does need to be answered. Otherwise, I've looked at this bill, and what it redounds to is this. We've fought for a long time to have the election code enforced. We want federal right to vote amendment. We don't have any of that. The Department of Homeland Security, by declaring it critical infrastructure, gets NIST involved, the Institute, the Technical Institute, and it advises the state election officials that go, your butt is on the line. You've got to keep your county registrars in line. You've got to tell them who's after this stuff. You've got to advise them how to protect this stuff. It's what we've been doing all along. That's what the bill says, HR 6073. I advise you to look at it because the devil will be in the details on this one, but the bottom line still is, unless we work our system in the county and become poll workers, it's how I found out everything, and I'm gonna leave you with this last thing, the whack-a-mole. Absentee voting is proliferating. Sooner or later, everybody's gonna get their absentee ballot in the mail, and yet there will still be polling places open or vote centers for 14 days of early voting. Not necessarily a bad thing, but a live online database, you could void your vote by mail ballot. Could go, I'm voting here. Any mail ballot comes in, that's not me, void it. And that goes on the record. Right now, it's nothing like that. And a live database, we all know, is never gonna work on election day. Sorry, it's gonna, no. You can't have anything connected to the, okay. So, many, 30 people come to me every election and go, oh, really, vote by mail? I never saw my ballot, I didn't use my ballot, I didn't bring my ballot, I didn't want my ballot, I don't know what you're talking about, nobody told me I had to bring it in. Well, you have to vote provisional. So I got 30 provisional votes, and I'm told, we'll count them as long as there's not an absentee ballot that comes in that voter's name. And I'm saying, why don't you at least take the provisional roster of names and record these people voted provisionally right away, election night. And don't count the damn absentee ballots until you know those names. You cannot do it. You cannot count an absentee ballot for a person who came to vote and said they didn't use their absentee ballot. And every election official I talk to goes, oh, I gotta chew on that for a while. Because they love their early counting the absentee vote because the media wants it. I'm fighting back. In-person voting, record that they came in. They didn't use their absentee ballot. Then and only then do you get to maybe count some kind of absentee ballot for that voter. That's my whack-a-mole moment for now. And this little thing doesn't address it because they didn't even think about process between absentee and provisional. Nobody's thinking about the sequence, and the sequence is always absentee first, provisionals last. That's got to reverse. Okay.
All right. Maybe you'll be staying up here for some questions and answers. You can tell that there's some overlap between me and her. It looks like she knows the legal cases. And the results I was in better than I am. I do. Absolutely correct. In 2012, I sued John Houston in Ohio, both in federal court, where it was thrown out, in the state court, where the judge said, I'm very familiar with Mr. Fitrakis' work. I think we'll keep this one open. So we considered that a victory, and also in King Lincoln, where we finally won the right to count the votes. I talked about this yesterday, and 56 of the 88 counties had accidentally destroyed all or most of the votes to be counted. All right, just a few housekeeping things. Trustvote.org, I was brought here by Trustvote, disclosed it. So were many of the speakers. Lori Grace, so if you want to go to that site, tremendous amount of information online at trustvote.org. Also, the people. The people that organized it on the practical level, GoFundMe.org, go to, again, Take Back the Vote. Take Back the Vote at GoFundMe.org to continue the work of these type of conferences. And Jim Soper has told me that the slides he put up earlier and now here are now online. So go to www.countedascast.org if you want Jim Soper's slides and PowerPoint that he showed earlier. Okay, with all that done, I'm only going to take about 5 minutes because my really good friend Jonathan Simon, who is here at the birth of the movement, I'm only going to give 5 minutes to on his book, and also Ralph Lopez, a great citizen activist I'm going to bring forward as well, who is suing over the election in Massachusetts. So again, a lot of people have asked me, and again, trustvote.org was the only one that signed on to give me any assistance. And literally it stated versus Goliath. Those of you who were here yesterday know that I'm suing Edison Research, the monopoly that does the exit polls and the cover-ups. I'm waiting for the judge to say you can't talk like that, Mr. Fitrakis. The cover-ups of absolute unacceptable corruption that occurred in the primary, I believe, is being done by Edison Research. Yeah. And I mentioned yesterday online that there had been protests there. It looks like Didier Jimenez sent me a picture this morning. He was out protesting. He heard the call, and he was out in front of Edison Research with a sign accusing them of election cover-up. The joys of live streaming. Thank you. Those of you who are in Massachusetts, you might want to go stop by Edison, tell them Bob, and all the election activists from California, say hi. Okay, so with that in mind, let me tell you. Most of you know that Edison Research, formerly Edison Matosky, and then Matosky died, not before Ron Bainman, who was working for the Columbus Free Press at the time, a great statistician, had asked them for their data in 2004. Mr. Matosky, being a professional, wrote him back, fuck off. So, I'm not sure that's in the code of ethics or the handbook of those that do exit polling, but maybe I'm wrong.
Well, maybe.
We actually printed that in one of the books. Our inquiry as professionals into what seemed like impossible polling numbers. So, we're not Edison Research, which is a monopoly that makes tens of millions of dollars. Works for the media cartel, right? The four networks, ABC, NBC, CBS, and Fox, as well as CNN, and the AP, who I understand finally learned how to count just prior to to the California primary, they discovered that Hillary Clinton had already won. So those are the six people in this cartel. And I am accusing them of being state actors, Edison Research, because no matter how bizarre the official numbers are in Arizona, in California, in Missouri, in Alabama, in Ohio, in Massachusetts, in Illinois, in 12 states, right? And Richard Charnin has said, again, I looked up, he's got a new book out on this, and Richard Charnin, who's often under attack for doing really great math, says the likelihood of those 12 out of the 26 states being that far outside the margin of error is one in every 77 billion elections. So if you times that by four times 77 billion, you get the likelihood of those results occurring naturally. So we want to know, why do you simply accept the official results from partisan for-profit machine companies with secret proprietary software that give money to the Clinton Foundation? It violates every principle of democracy. HIG, which owns Heart Inner Civic, the third largest, gave donations to the Clinton Foundation. Dominion, after Wright and Diebold went down, remember the quote, a worldwide pattern of fraud. Diebold, which then merged with ESNS, and they couldn't do it, so then it went off to Dominion. So they gave money to the Clinton Foundation. So, and again, it's fitting, because in the world there's only two ways to settle things, bullets and ballots. The Saudis clearly gave $35 million because they wanted bullets, weapons, and licenses to sell weapons and attack Yemenites in the Middle East. The other thing is ballots, that sense of legitimacy. As the CIA called it, demonstration democracy, where you hold an election to establish artificial legitimacy. That's what they're doing now, and the people in this room have not only uncovered it, but instead of shrinking in fear, are outraged and courageous. So it's a great privilege for me to be here today. Where my case is this, right? I submitted a complaint saying you're a media cartel, you're working for a cartel, you're a monopoly, you're in collusion. You're with the Secretary of State who's perpetuating fraud on the people of Ohio and throughout the United States. I sued in federal court. So they have responded pretty much saying, you're gonna be sanctioned. They, of course, they're always gonna sanction me. When I sued in Moss v. Bush with Cliff Arnebeck and Susan Truitt and Pete Prakarsky, they were gonna sanction us then too. They sent me out on a speaking tour here in California, and one of the things I did at the time, I let everyone know that, you know, they were gonna pull my law license and charge me $75, so I couldn't say much. But let me, you know, send the same message I sent at the time. Yeah, is that open defiance. Yeah. You got, if you sanction me, you can't get it dismissed. You have to give me a hearing. And what we did last time, when they threatened to sanction us, we dumped 30,000 documents into the record, and suddenly the Supreme Court justice in Ohio said, maybe it's not real fair to sanction them. Now, just sanction me and give me a hearing. I do not fear your monopoly, and the people in this room, I do not fear it. You are some of the bravest and best activists in America. And I know that I'm not going there alone, but I have your good wishes, and really this movement started in California, and it's why I love
to come here. Lutheran said it so. We responded, they responded, we're waiting for the judge to rule. I hope they give us discovery, because there is much corruption to discover and bring forth to the public. So with that in mind, enough about my case. I'll keep you posted. Go to trustvote.org. We'll keep you updated there. But with that in mind, let me bring up again Ralph Lopez first, and then in the last 5 minutes, my good friend Jonathan Simon. Ralph, another courageous activist who is suing initially pro bono. So come on up.
Thanks, Bob. This is an awe-inspiring experience. I can't believe I'm here with all these people who are heroes to me, all of you included. So you've worked your hearts out. You, after maybe being apathetic in politics for a little while, you discover a candidate who's starting to say things that excite you, and you start getting involved again, and you start giving a little bit of money, maybe $27 here from your paycheck. You start getting more excited as you hear more of this candidate. The movement grows, the rallies get bigger, and then you start phone banking, and you start thinking maybe there's a real possibility for change here. And you work harder, and you start going door to door, and you go to cold places door to door, and hot places door to door, to campaign for this candidate. And at the end of the process, you find out that all of that meant exactly nothing, because the winner was already predetermined. This is a dangerous thing, because no less than one of our greatest presidents, John F. Kennedy, said, "Those who make peaceful revolution impossible make violent revolution inevitable." And that's something I never want to see in my lifetime, and neither do anybody here. So we can work our hearts out in a different way. I'm here to report the story in Massachusetts, what I'm doing on mass election justice. The day after the primary in Massachusetts, we found out that the vote for Bernie in districts where the ballots were hand counted was Bernie winning 18%. Over Hillary Clinton. In districts where the ballots were counted by machine, Hillary won by about a percent. So we thought, what's going on here? And essentially, I and some other citizens got the feed together and essentially said to the Secretary of State, after he had certified the election for Hillary, not so fast. We said, not so fast. Filed a lawsuit in Suffolk Superior Court saying, we want some of those ballot boxes opened up and we want them counted by hand. We want you to prove to us that those machines are not giving us a fraudulent answer. And so we have some good news to report. Basically, the lawsuit has not been dismissed. We have a court date, November 30th, we will stand before a judge and begin to explain our position and demand that these ballots be counted. And we will make it a media circus from all us activists in Massachusetts. We urge you to tune in on our Facebook. Our Facebook is Hand Count the Ballots. Our website is handcounttheballots.blogspot.com. And for those of you in the live stream audience that don't know about this report, aren't familiar with this report, it is called Democracy Lost. This is the cover page, a report on the fatally flawed 2016 Democratic primaries. I am also here to offer help and let people know out there in the live stream audience that you do not need an attorney to file what we have filed and demand they open your ballot boxes, because wonderful attorneys like Bob here cannot be every place at once. and you can do something called filing pro se, which is the Latin term for filing for yourself, arguing for yourself. We would especially like to hear from people in these states, Alabama, Georgia, West Virginia, New York, South Carolina, Ohio, Mississippi, Texas, and Tennessee. These are big, important states. These are states that could swing the election. Please contact us at handcounttheballots@gmail.com, and we will help you, and Bob, I'm sure, will be happy to consult with us, and if Arne Beck, I've spoken to him many times. We need to use the judicial branch to do what the executive branch will not do, and find honest, upright judges who will say, I see no reason why you should try to be keeping those ballots secret and why they can't count them if they want to, because that's what they are there for.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And finally, Co-Rec, I mean, Jonathan has been here since the beginning. He came in for the first major conference we had in Ohio and keynoted it. He's the guy that essentially grabbed the unadjusted polls that history will record as one of the great turning points in the election integrity movement. And co-read an essential book because it goes into the question of polling and what my suit's about, these exit polls. And you recall what they did here in California when Cliff Arnebeck sent out a hold notice to Edison that we were going to sue them, they decided there would be no more exit polls. And again, what they say is those exit polls can't be used to predict elections. I told you yesterday, they predicted the election off the exit polls in Ohio 45 minutes before a single vote was reported in the state. And I know because I called up the Board of Elections and began to talk very loud. They go, look, we just haven't sent them out yet. So yeah, and by the way, they're used all over planet Earth. All over planet Earth is the international gold standard. Our very own government, the Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton, used them to determine what is a legitimate election. The same companies are involved. So I give you the author of Code Red, and this is the new edition, very important, Jonathan Simon.
Thanks, Bob, and thanks for everybody listening in and everybody who's here. I just want to say first that, you know, Code Red does touch quite a bit upon exit polls, but one of the places it goes is that we've been trying to, quote unquote, prove election theft through indirect methods such as exit polls and comparative counts and baselines and cumulative vote share analysis and stuff for the better part of 15 years, basically since the computers went in. And one of the things I do in the new edition of Code Red, the 2016 edition, is kind of pivot away from that and say this is really a battle over information. Whose ballots are they? To whom do the ballots belong? Are these public or are these private? Is this corporate property? This is really what it's about. And, you know, just like with the NSA and surveillance, a lot of the battles today are about information and control of information. So it's really about the public regaining its sovereignty, regaining the right and the duty to be participants in its democracy by not just voting, but by being participants in the counting and observing of the count of the votes. That's really what it's about. As long as we got, you know, I'll be doing forensics on this election, as I have since 2002, but if that's what we keep presenting and we keep getting shot down, ignored, ridiculed, called conspiracy theorists, we're kind of running in place. So, you know, I've been, for those of you who know me, you know that I can brighten up a room by leaving it, and you know, not to, I don't want to close things on on any sort of downer. I've heard so many good plans and proposals and ideas and initiatives and some that are actually making a certain amount of progress, but the overall feeling I have is that we're kind of rowing in a boat and the current is going against the boat. For all the places where we're making progress on, you know, ballot as public record, there are a lot of states where mostly Republican legislatures, but there's a lot of Democratic complicity in this as well, are taking those same ballots and removing them from public records, making exemptions of ballots from public records law. So, you know, the big picture, I mean, I go out there, I look for evidence of election theft, of miscounting and all that, and we keep finding it. But the big picture is that this election game is rolling along and will continue to roll along. A lot of the legislation we want passed is not going to be passed, and if it is passed, it's a slow vote. And the courts are very unresponsive, and the media is very unresponsive, the New York Times, the Mother Jones, the Nation, all of them. So, you know, this is a reality. And where I've come out in Code Red, even though it's about computerized election theft, I've come out with some pretty bold and I would say controversial action proposals. And the whole point of writing a book like Code Red is that we don't have enough public awareness. I mean, we don't have enough buy-in to democracy. I mean, we're the ones that are caring, we're putting this out there, task forces, all that, but we are not mobbed, you know? We don't have 50,000 people come down and say, yeah, we want our democracy back. You saw a little bit of that with the Bernie Sanders campaign, and then you saw what happened. Because the candidates themselves, anybody with anything to lose, anybody, with a few very minor exceptions, but anybody, with even Jill Stein, with a platform, with a place at the adults' table, turns their back. The elites don't want democracy. This is the reality. And, you know, you can almost excuse that if you look at the public at large and say, well, what is public sovereignty? And you got 100 million people following the Kardashians, maybe you can understand why people who have multiple degrees and stuff don't really give that much of a damn about public sovereignty. But we are the public, and as the church has said, democracy is the worst form of government except for all the others. So what we need awareness, we need alarm, we need a buy-in to democracy. One of the things I advocate in Code Red is what I call op-stand parties. People going down, circling an op-stand, saying, 12 people, let's say, we're not moving until that op-stand is opened up and these ballots are, and a public count is initiated, even if it's symbolic, even if it's just a one race. And this does not necessarily, certainly shouldn't be violent. We're not talking about Trump vigilantes coming down and saying, we didn't lose, goddammit. We're talking about a transparency of a process. Who owns those ballots? Is it the corporations or is it the public? And we want to make very clear that it's the public. And so this doesn't have to be confrontational. This can be in cooperation with election administrators, with poll administrators that are also understanding about what is required of a democracy. So, you know, it's a controversial ask. But it's something that I think we've crossed the line. There's a lot of distrust now in our politics. There's a lot of disgust in our politics. We've seen where it's gone. And that, in a way, gives an opportunity for a revision, for one of those peaceful revolutions. And we have to seize that. And we have to take those steps to reassert the public's right and duty to be participants in the voting and vote counting process.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
This last session, it's a question and answer session. Where do we go from here? My title, What is to be Done? Okay, that's a lucky joke. Was canceled. Where do we go from here? Derek Cressman, Mimi Kennedy, Barbara Simon, and Lori Grace. I'd like opening a brief two-minute statement. What is the agenda, the public agenda?
I tell everyone this.
go on your website to your county, be a poll worker, and look at when the classes are. That's number one. What day can you go to a poll worker class? Intend to go to the class. Even, I was told, well, unless we've sent you an affirmation that you are a poll worker, you don't get to go to the class. Oh, yeah, I went to the class. Anyway, that's public information. You can find out how we're being trained. So do that in your county. Be a poll worker. You will find what the problems are. As I say, I am suspicious of provisional versus absentee because I find our Democratic officials to be very unresponsive to my questions and worries about the lack of chain of custody in an absentee ballot versus the better custody of a provisional ballot of somebody who didn't get their absentee and didn't have to surrender, and they've never advertised the surrender rule, which is the easiest way to avoid all the provisional voting. Just tell people, your absentee ballot, find out if you're getting one, because it is gold. You can't vote regularly if you don't surrender. Anyway, that's number one, be a poll worker and go to the class even if they say you can't be. And number two, the LA voting system that I demonstrate, go to YouTube, Meany Kennedy LA voting system. It's all you gotta look at. And that's the future for me in my county. It's not perfect by any means, but it's a paper ballot based system and it's human readable, hand countable, very accessible for everybody in every language, the disability community. So we have a solution, but now we have to monitor it and get involved, and I want to do it. It depends on our statewide database being live, beautiful, unhacked, and maybe even online. I don't see how that can happen. That's what the DHS bill is about. How do we help the Secretaries of State solidify all that stuff? And how do we criminalize anybody who goes in and tries to mess it up? I don't know what the answer is there, but I'm involved in a solution in LA, locally, that is going to be dependent on that, so we're following that. So where we go from here is paper ballots. Everybody that's out there listening, you don't all have them. You know you need them. No matter what you do, go to your poll worker classes so you can report on how your state and county is training people to receive voters and help the voter obstruct them. And that's my advice. Thank you. And I want to shout out Judy Hess here. I forgot to tell you that you're asking the Fresno Registrar when they were going to do the random selection of precincts, and her telling you, we did that 2 months ago. What? You pre-selected a random precinct you're going to audit? Yes, in this bill, the federal bill, H.R. 6072, it says after the election. After the election. Which you can ask for. And the John Simon provision is 10% audits, but unfortunately only if you're within a 1 percentage point in your race. It should really be 10% across the board, in my book. Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Where do we go from here?
Okay. So some of the things that I would like to do is have you join us, all of us join together in educating a larger part of our population. We have decided, Bob and I, to go on against Edison Media Research. And, you know, if we lose it, then we want media to come forward, and we need alternative media support. We do already have it from Lee Camp. I've been thinking of Tom Hartman, Reader Supported News, different places where we can serve the education, because what's happened is all of us can be educators. All of you who have taken time to learn here can also educate. Additionally, I want to encourage you to, we have the lawsuits of Bill Simpich that are going to support better education for poll workers, also improved observer, rules for observers, and I see that as very important because for me, observing in California, being so far back, observing, I really didn't get much from it. So I believe in that, and I believe in also really educating people that we've got the 1% is counting our votes and in terms of these large corporations, and the 1% is also doing our exit polls. And so I want to bring forward, and I would have said to Bernie, who said, you know, start a new political system in here. All of you run for office. If in some of the higher positions, the 1% is counting your votes and it's proprietary, and you can't look at the software, we've got to change that to make sure that our votes count. So those are a few of the things that I want to say that the other people that I've brought to this meeting can really use media support as well. Ralph Lopez, who you just heard from, Bill Sinthich, who presented yesterday, John Brakey, Paul Thomas. You know, all of these are important causes, and whether we win or lose one particular thing, if we can get it out there as an educational vehicle and Facebook it and all of this, that would be great. And trustvote.org is Donna's both his Facebook page and, you know, and its website. And so I hope you join it at info@trustvote.org because we give regular presentations. We send out many things, especially on the mailing list. So thank you.
There are two big changes that are coming in California that I think this community should be aware of and ready for future elections. One is with VoteCal coming online in the next elections, we will be able to implement same-day voter registration. And that could be a key thing, both in terms of boosting participation, but also fixing some of the problems we saw in the last primary, where people showed up, they thought they were going to be able to vote, and they were told, sorry, you can't, you're registered Green, you're registered Republican, you can't vote in the Democratic primary. If that happens in the future, you will be able to re-register on the spot and be able to cast a live ballot. But people need to know that. So there's a public education lift that there will be a new change in same-day voter registration. Second big change that's coming that other speakers have talked about is this transition to vote centers as well as more vote by mail. And what is that going to mean for poll workers and monitors? I think there are pros and cons. You know, on the one hand, it'll be fewer locations to monitor, but they will be open longer. Hopefully, there will be better trained poll workers and staff since there are fewer locations, but the stakes will be much higher because you'll have tens of thousands of people voting
any ballot there. You know that. Yes. There.
Yes. So, big opportunities, I think, for better monitoring at those vote centers. And then in terms of, we will be seeing greater numbers of people voting by mail at home, and there are some pros and cons of that, and that changes how we think about monitoring as well, especially if you think about voter suppression, right? We know there are voter suppression problems at polling places. We have presidential candidates urging voter suppression at polling places right now. But voter suppression can also happen within a household, from a spouse or other member of that house. It can happen in a workplace. We've had employers sending letters to their employees telling them, here's how we think that you should vote. So I think we will need more vigilance monitoring voting from home. And you know, we'll need 800 numbers and hotlines and training for people on how to report that and possibly correct a ballot that they felt they cast under coercion. So these are big changes, and we need to be thinking about monitoring not only voting in the polling place, but voting in the home.
So one of the major problems that none of us has addressed yet, but that is, I think, confronting all of us, is we spend far too little money on elections.
Yep.
Far too little money. If we spent the amount of money we should be spending, which I would say, you know, several times what we spend now, there wouldn't be this move to vote by mail, in my opinion. I mean, election officials are moving to vote by mail because they don't want to have to pay for precinct-based voting. And I personally don't like vote by mail because of the reasons that you said, because of coercion and vote buying. Also, it's one of the most insecure forms of voting, as compared, not compared to internet voting, mind you, but compared to precinct-based voting. It's much more insecure because ballots can be stolen, ballots can be forged. It's just not, I think, not a very good trend, but that's what's happening because we aren't spending the money that we need to spend now. There are a few positive things happening. So Mimi mentioned the LA work. There's work in LA County.
Yes.
LA County, Travis County, Texas, which is Austin. There's a not-for-profit group that is working, all of them, on open source voting systems. And when these systems are ready to go, which unfortunately they aren't yet, but when they are, they'll be a lot less expensive.
Yeah.
They will be open source, so the whole concern about proprietary software will be eliminated. And it should be possible when these systems are available to replace them relatively cheaply, which of course is very important given what I just said about not spending enough money. There was also this comment about observing elections, which I think is very important. And I mentioned earlier that I had the experience of being a poll worker in Canada. In Canada, they have a system for observers. You basically sign up. I was looking at my computer, I was trying to find the word and I can't remember it, but they have a name for people. They sign up, they can be party representatives, or I think they can be not party representatives. They get a badge and they go to the polling place. And then when the ballots are being counted, they look over the shoulders of the counters. I mean, I was counting ballots and someone was standing right behind me watching. And we could institute a system like that in this country where we basically people sign up and then they get, you know, so they're sort of certified. But I mean, there wasn't, I think anybody could have done it. And then they get this privilege, really, of going in and looking very, very closely. And so the political parties have representatives, and I think it would be a much healthier system if we would have that here, too. So that's just a few thoughts off the top of my head.
All right, question time.
I'm Katie Henke, and I found myself as an activist in Secretary of State Padilla's office days before the election, with bundles of petitions asking him to call an emergency on the vote and open up the primary so that people could write in on the NDP ballots and that all ballots be counted, of course, we were left out of the office. However, it has brought me to a place that I never imagined myself. I'm kind of a visionary who's been informed. And working with other activists who are also visionaries, we have an idea to basically, on a nationwide level, take back the election. And I don't know if this is possible, but we have been working on the language around this. Plan on setting up a website shortly, which will be takebackelections.org.com. And as we all know, you know, the basis of change in this country hinges on the elections. And we also know that this is nothing short of really changing the government and asking the government in a big way to shift, which is horrifying to stand here and ask for that. It's very, it takes a lot of guts. At any rate, the election process, we all know, is onerous, and we need to simplify it so that across the board, we're not having separate precincts, separate, you know, so that it's unified, and that it takes the question out of it. And this would be coming in the way of a lot of the stuff that has been talked about here with hand-counted paper ballots, and so forth and so on.
Okay, let me see if I can get a question on that. Jimmy Carter told Der Spiegel we have a dysfunctional democracy, and recently I received a letter from his grandson saying the Carter Center does not monitor American elections because there's no national standards. Is this a problem? Can it be cured?
This bill tries to cure it. I would just say that a wish for simplicity in our elections is probably going to create 5 years of extreme frustration because it's not a simple matter. Local government and some of the other things that are in there make it very necessary for many different ballots, and that starts to, you go from there. It's just a cautionary word, but I love that you're doing what you're doing.
There's a lot of concern in this room that is completely legitimate and warranted, but I'm actually very hopeful for this movement going forward. From my perspective, I've been working on these issues about 20 years, huge uptick in interest in election integrity issues after 2000, particularly in the debacle in Florida, and then quite frankly, it's been a little bit challenging to sustain that level of energy, and I feel like this round of recent elections has brought in a whole new generation of people who understand the importance of the nuts and bolts and getting down into the weeds and showing up and observing. And I think our challenge now is how do we capture this moment and this new wave of citizen activists who can maintain the vigilance that we're going to need for the next 15 to 20 years.
Just a couple brief comments. I just want to second what other people have said. Be poll workers. I think that's a really important thing to do. I found it quite an eye-opening experience when I did it for the first time. And another thing that I would urge people to do is, if you go to the Verified Voting website, and I guess I'm talking to everybody here, not just the people in this room, you can find out what kind of technology is being used in your area. If you've got a DRE, if they're using some sort of DRE technology, organize with your friends and pressure election officials to get rid of them.
Yep.
What website was that?
Verifiedvoting.org, www.verifiedvoting.org. Click on the verifier. That's one of the pull-down links. It breaks down, it shows a map of the United States with each state describing what kinds of technologies are used because many of them have multiple different kinds.
Yes.
And then it breaks down into the precinct level or the jurisdiction level, and you can actually go down to your the area where you vote and find out what kind of voting machines, who makes them, are being used. And if they are not adequate, start pressuring election officials to get rid of them.
And I would also add that if you are in a state that uses primarily DREs, I would try to get an absentee ballot at this last minute here. Because they won't get rid of them at this point, right now. I was saddened to see that Pennsylvania, who's mostly DREs, doesn't give any kind of permanent absentee ballot, and you have to apply, and it's difficult. But I still would do it if I lived in Pennsylvania. It might be too late, but that's what I would do in one of these difficult states.
Go ahead.
Thank you. First, thank you all for the work you have done. It's just amazing. So thank you so much. Myself as European, I'm not saying much. I'm concerned about the situation, not only because this has consequences here in America, but also in North America, but also in Europe. As you know. So this is really major. We see what can be done internationally. Now, there are two points I would like to bring up. One, maybe quick, maybe a suggestion to put on one of your websites some information regarding what can be videotaped in the election poll. Because if I'm gonna, I'll try to volunteer, I definitely will go there with a video camera. I would like to know what the laws are. And so if you can bring me some information regarding this point. I don't know the law, I'm sure there is funding from doing it. I think that's important. I'm pretty sure all over the country people will be very interested in this information to be really firm when necessary.
Okay.
The other point is I would like to bring up a topic that we did not talk about during this. Part of the election fraud is the fraud in the opinion poll. The opinion poll are based on the age of 40 years old and above. That's why they show just 95%. The similar concern is for libertarian, I'm really not talking as I really don't care which one I got elected. It's so messy. So I'm not talking as in a political stand position, but really biased, but really the opinion poll are a major, major point. Now, I'd like to bring my brother and I work together, he's a scientist, he's listening right now, so he's not just US. Now, he's bringing up a point that Richard Charney, for everybody, is a statistician, maybe knowledgeable, he worked since 1965 on the election in the US. He's recognized as one of the most knowledgeable men about the statistics in the US. Now, he says, to believe a quote, to believe the media polls, you must believe that Jill Stein has just 5% of independents and Democrats. But Bernie has had 65-70% of independents in the primaries. And Jill Stein should be doing nearly as well against Clinton. Now, I skip a few things, but according to the election model, partly a deviation from the Gallup statistic, you can see that right now Stein should have 20% about, just Clinton 30%, Trump 35%, Johnson 15%. Now, skipping two things, the point is that the danger is this. Now we have this false number, but the day of the election, the numbers will be real, supposedly. Imagine no rigging of elections, which is what we are trying to do. If that happened, the people, the independent, will take, will at least in the most conservative analysis by Richard, Jill Stein cannot have less than 20%. So she will take a minimum 10% away from Clinton. That means, according to Richard Stein, I quote, Trump will win in his landslide. This is what we are facing right now. And so we are wondering if it is possible to, I know it's impossible, but it's still pretty hard, to put together an alternative opinion poll to make it case. You know, in this country, because right now we are under the cartel of the media. So that was the question.
Thank you so much.
Okay, does anyone want to address that or take it as a comment? Okay, thank you for the comments. Next.
Thank you. This is an on time and a group of people to be with. I really want to thank Ballots for Bernie. It's through that organization that I was informed of my right to be a citizen observer, and it has been a very enriching experience. I want to underscore something that Mimi Kennedy said, and I will translate what I say afterwards. Я американка. Ну, я говорю по-русски, и я не думаю, что русским народом является нашим проблемам. На самом деле, наша проблема является наш сломанный систем голосования. И это уже проблема всегда. So, what I said is, I was born in San Francisco, I'm American, but I speak Russian, and I do not believe that the Russian people are our problem. Our problem is... It's hard to even really think about what we're looking for as observers. Is it which thief is going to rob which criminal? I don't, you know, I'd love to have some coaching in what we're looking for, but it occurs to me that one of the strategies that Hillary Clinton used that was not illegal was to encourage her voter base to vote early. And I'm aware that we can go in on Monday and vote already. I plan on going in to vote for Jill Stein on Monday. And as much as I really believe in voting at a poll place on election day, I'm thinking with all the media and all everything stacked against us that perhaps we have an opportunity to go in, vote early, and then tell everybody who we voted for and just make it known to our friends and communities because there's a lie. It's basically we're being told not to vote for Jill Stein because no one else will. Well, if that part of the lie is taken away, then, and I'm speaking for myself and my personal choice because, you know, everybody has their choice of who they're going to vote for. But I think that at midnight tonight, when we all watch the video that is going to be released, can someone remind me the name of this video? YouTube video, we're going to be feeling that it would be very difficult to vote for Hillary Clinton when we observe the fractions and what's going on with the voting machines. Okay, thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
Just one point for the record, since we're election integrity activists, on one basic level, we don't care who wins. What we're fighting for is a transparent and fair system that we can trust. So our commitment is to democracy and transparency, not to any candidate.
Thank you for taking my question. I think I have a question. So I live in San Francisco, and I know that they're working on open source.
Yeah.
And I was a San Francisco poll worker observer. I tried to go to the audit, and it was, you know, roped off. I was roped off like 6 feet away at least, so I couldn't really see the audit. I don't think San Francisco ever posted anything about the results of the 1% audit. So I'm wondering what would be the best way to, you know, if they do move to the open source, how to push them so that we can also have better audits.
Ask questions about process. By the time you're seeing an audit, you really can't count the votes yourself, but you can say, what are they doing? Where did those ballots come from? Where do you keep the other ballots? Where are the provisionals? When will you be counting those? Why are those stacked over there? It was questions asked by people like Judy Huss, getting surprising answers, and you call someone and go, I got this answer. Is it legal, what he or she told me? And you post your answers, Ballots for Bernie, online. I am telling you, asking questions about process is the most important thing you can do during the audit. You can't see, really, the votes being counted, but you can see how they handle the ballots, and anything that occurs to you, you may think it's a stupid question, but it's not. If you don't know the answer, then your election officials might know the answer and has to tell you. And then you learn and share the answer. And if they go, that's none of your business, you share that answer. You share any answer you get for any question you ask. That's what auditing an election and observing the canvas, the vote counting, is all about. And it's really effective. And we just started to do it en masse. Thank you, everybody who has done it.
I do not, first of all, what they call those observers in Canada, I remember scrutineers, in case you're wondering. Scrutineers. I also live in San Francisco. San Francisco has a modified ranked choice voting system where you vote for your top three in order, 1, 2, 3. It's actually pretty damn hard to audit. What they do in the city is they randomly select 1% of the ballots and then run a mini election on it, which doesn't really accurately reflect what the overall election is. It's not, I mean, because it could be different with the 1% sample work versus the whole thing, the way ranked choice voting works. So I think it's a problem. It is a problem, and it's actually a meaningless audit in San Francisco because of ranked choice voting. I mean, it's not the fault of the election official. He tries his best. It just...
In the June primary, I don't think there were any ranked choice.
I think that's right. But in November, there will be.
Yeah, hi, my name is Mark Shipley. I live in North Oakland, Alameda County. And I think we all see there's a historic amount of interest in election integrity right now and voting rights because of Bernie and because of Shelby v. Holder, especially in the black community. There's now a voting rights caucus newly formed in Congress. And there's just a lot of interest in this. Yet in this room, we see, you know, you can count the people of color on one hand. I'm wondering if there's been any discussion about a national conference after this election, or in this election season, that will bring together all of these movements, including like the Brennan Center, John Lewis, the Voting Rights Caucus, Ari Berman, you know, people who have done a lot of work on this, just bringing all of us together, because I haven't seen that happen.
I want you to know that it is happening. The Congressional Black Caucus brought together the Brennan Center. There are a couple of groups, and they're mostly East Coast based, because one of the things about our West Coast is we live in very segregated communities, and it takes a lot of travel time and gas and everything to get to places, and you might be working or taking care of kids. It's tough. The East Coast is a little denser. They know each other a little better, and that's our federal legislators. So there, that's why Hank Johnson's doing this, and finally, as I say, there's this breakthrough where the Brennan Center has convinced them technology is at risk, and it has been a problem. Voter suppression is an obvious problem. So if you, well, I know my group, People Demanding Action, there are quite a few. Representative Hank Johnson might look on his website, for instance. You might find Congressional Black Caucus. Look at that. Now, where you might be able to go, you could repeat this somehow yourself with, you know, but you have to be in a, like a Black Lives Matter, you know, go on
demonstration.
National, that's happening in Washington, and People Demanding Action is really part of that, which is a part of Progressive Democrats of America. We have to spin off. I don't mean to toot my own horn, but that's the one I know about. Oh, when is it? The Congressional Black Caucus already had their retreat that talked about all this, I believe in September. But it's kind of ongoing. There's more and more meetings, but they're all East Coast, because that's where the federal legislators meet, and mostly that's what I know about.
I think a national conference and many ongoing national conferences are a really important part of this. I also think it's important for the different strains of the pro-democracy movement to really listen to each other's concerns. And I actually think we've made a lot of progress in this. And I think back, 10, 15 years ago, and you had this issue of DREs and paper trails, and you had voting rights communities in love with this idea because of the idea that you could have different languages easily pop up on these screens, and the election integrity, community going, wait, this is going to be a disaster, there's no paper ballot to audit, And there was, I think, more dissension then, and it has taken years of being willing to think about not only the concerns that are most foremost in your mind, but other concerns too. And if you're working with a community where 50% of them aren't even registered to vote, how those votes are counted is not necessarily their top concern. But it's becoming an additional concern. So I feel like it's important to have these conferences, but it's also important to put yourself in other people's shoes when you're at those conferences and think about how we can reinforce each other. And we've made a lot of progress in this area, and I think we'll continue.
Let me just say, Benny Smith, who founded Fraction Magic, is African-American from Georgia. And I said, Benny, what's your story? And he said, the way I was brought up, I saw a lot of violence, and I heard a lot of I love you. He was well-loved. But in a difficult community, he said, I was always looking for the next thing that was going to come up. I was hardwired to watch out. And he said, when I learned how to research databases, I'm hardwired to look for what's really going on here. And he found Fraction Magic. There is an amazing unity, and above all, people of color know they will get screwed any which way that the power can screw them. And they understand now that means technology too, of course, as well as the brazen and open ways that too often people, white people, don't, that barely knows, have kind of heard about Mississippi. Greg Palast's movie, by the way, The Best Democracy Money Can Buy, is the quickest hour and a half tutorial in this that I have ever seen, and everybody wants to go see it.
Next.
Hi, thank you all. He kind of stole my question because we did a little outreach, but we had to rush into this conference to get it done before the election. It didn't make a difference. But looking around this room, we don't have people of color here. And I want to encourage everyone to reach out to that community and get them involved. Maybe we can get some funding for that sort of aspect of election justice. And do you folks know, and everyone here, but we have to try to go beyond our comfort zone and involve the Black community and the Latino community and others. We heard from the Asian community yesterday to do that, because that's power. That's real power.
Agreed.
Okay?
Agreed.
Is there any, do you know of any funding you can get for that kind of outreach?
There are already people doing it, so they might have funding that can use.
But I think the funding really goes to voter suppression and not election integrity. And when we made calls to get people of color, experts like you here, there was none.
Yeah.
Well, so I think that's what she's saying. We want you experts to help us find the people of color that are like
what
you.
People should remember is the original movement was overwhelmingly Black in Ohio. The court case was Moss v. Bush, who was a Black nationalist. The hearings were held in Black Baptist Church. 500 people showed up. I think the nature of the primary, the last kind of it appeared to be college millennial students, at least in Ohio, who were targeting, and that group seemed absolutely unprepared. Well, the Black community always seems to suspect it and be self-organized and re-registered the voters. They've done tremendous work, but we're absolutely right. And there's all sorts of stuff going on in Washington. I had the privilege of being brought in for those things, but there's a tremendous movement in the Washington, D.C. area, which we need to hook up with here on the West Coast and me from the Midwest. But the point is very well taken.
So this is two questions. One, you know, there's video cams, there's body cams, there's, you know, in cities, like one out of every 10 people are basically covered on these cameras. What about having cameras in these poll places where we can actually watch what's happening? I'm talking about when you're counting the ballots, the poll ballots.
That's appropriate technology, video cameras on the ballots.
So yes, absolutely, yeah. But there is this related idea. In fact, there was a bill that didn't actually get signed. I don't think it's
450.
Legalize people taking pictures of themselves, a selfie with their ballot before they put it in the mail, and that I think is problematic. It can lead to vote selling, it can lead to voter intimidation. It's a compromise about secrecy. On the counting end, yes. On the casting end, no.
Chain of custody should be videotaped. There should be wire cages at all the registrars, and the ballots are in there, and you should see who comes in and takes them out. Beth Harris in the Fraction Magic video she will post tonight has people running computers out of the registrars once they got a settlement to look at the computers. And it's on the security cameras that they're running out these computers and putting them in the boot of a car, boot, Canadian, and then they're made to take them back by a judge because they want to have the judge. Like, they're making the computers leave, they're taking them out. The judge goes, no, he comes back and goes, put them back in. It's hilarious and horrifying, and you must see it.
I am aware that both in the San Diego area and New York, I saw videotapes of observers told that they couldn't use their cell phones for taking pictures. So,
there is a limit to what you can do personally. You know, photographing voters. No, that's not cool. Oh, what? Or your ballot?
Observing the recount and taking pictures of the ballot.
Oh, they can't. Yeah, I know they do. I know that's probably not good. People don't want their faces and then it turns out badly. I mean, in Florida, remember the group, the Republican operatives went down there and tried to riot, and there were these people doing their job counting ballots. But I've always thought on the hands and on the ballots, you can do it. You don't have to involve people that don't want to be in, you know, with their personal faces involved while they're doing their civic duty. But there's all kinds of ways one can do it. It's just that everybody with a cell phone at this point, what are the rules? I mean, I think you should be able to, they're just, I don't, you know, they're
I definitely saw election officials saying, no, you're going to have to, you know, turn off your cell phones.
I think that's for the employees. I think they do that for
San Diego.
But they were going to take pictures of what was going on, the recount. So that means the county employees are now on camera doing the recount without possibly their assent or whatever.
I would argue as an attorney, they're public employees. While the cameras should create the transparency. We had this problem in Ohio in 2004 where the Secretary of State, Ken Blackwell, anytime the vote count didn't match, he brought in the same man from the SNS known as Honest Sam Hogsett, who we found in the newspaper saying that his fondest dream in life was to shoot a liberal in the head. So right before the liberal's death, he would know that he, Sam Hogsett, had killed him, not the gun. So that was, again, we couldn't observe him, right? He was off in a magic room. So transparency and lawsuits over the right to observe means that you can see what's going on.
Yes.
It should be part of the job.
Yeah, I have one other question. The idea of maybe when you turn 18, you get a handheld voting device sent to you, and it's activated by your own thumbprint, your own eye retina. I mean, that could be another way, because there's all these biometrics that are coming out with technology. And then the results get sent to 20 different independent data analyst centers, and their numbers have to match up. And if they don't match up, then I guess they're not a legitimate data analyst center.
I have a couple of problems with that. First of all, what I said earlier, no money. We were not even spending, we don't even have money to get rid of the DREs, and this is going to, would be another significant cost. For others, it sounds a little bit like a an ID card, and there's a lot of opposition to ID cards in this country. And in fact, voter ID, there's a lot of opposition to voter ID. I think probably in this room, there's a lot of opposition to voter ID. And since I have the mic, I thought I would just make one other quick comment that I forgot to make since we're talking about films. There's another film, a documentary also called I Voted? Which is coming, which is going to be shown at Stanford on October 29th, I believe, Saturday at 3 o'clock. And it talks about the 2010 Democratic primary in South Carolina where Alvin Green won. This is paperless voting machines. Alvin Green is somebody who I think didn't have a home address or something bizarre like that. Nobody knew of him except the name sounded like Singer's name. And that might be why he went, or it might be the voting machines, because he was the weakest possible candidate imaginable. So this is a documentary made about that whole situation in South Carolina, and I've seen earlier versions of it. I think you will find it interesting.
What's it called?
I Voted? And it's going to be shown at a film festival. I can look at my computer and find out the name of it. UN is in the name, at Stanford University at 3 o'clock on October 29th, which I believe is a Saturday, if I've got the date right. And I can look it up, and next time I get the mic, I can tell you the name of the festival.
Quick.
Okay. My name is Olga Osborne. My nickname is Raven. I live in San Francisco. And I have two questions. One is, first of all, so many Bernie Sanders supporters, and I'm a Bernie Sanders supporter myself, are going to write in his name, you know, in this election. And I'm wondering what your thoughts are about that. You know, will that count? No. Will they throw that out?
There's a rule.
Okay, could you say
there's a rule. There's a rule in the Secretary of the Election Code that the only write-in candidates who will be counted are those that are on the list of official write-in candidates for that election. And I don't think Bernie put his name in for probably, you know, political reasons, and Bernie's people didn't know to organize to get his name on the ballot. But that's a rule I found out in the primary. You can't write, then you can write in any name you want, but it's not, if it's not on the list, and I as a poll worker had to have the list on the table going, you want to write in? Here are the people that you can write in. Otherwise, it's going to be thrown out. It's a rule.
And some states have sore loser laws, so even if he had wanted to put his name in, he wouldn't have been allowed to be an official right in. Ohio has a sore loser law.
But I think there's 10 states that allow it just to be wide open.
There are some states that will count any writing.
Okay. Wow. So I just have one other question. If something should happen to one of the Frankenrellers or even both of them, if they step down, what would the process look like at that point in the ballots? Because I know they're already prepared and ready for action. So if, you know, even Trump last night, there was something about he's going to have to step down. And then, of course, Hillary. If Hillary stepped down for some reason at the last minute, would Bernie step forward, or they would appoint somebody that they want?
I think it will depend on the state. In my state of Ohio, what would happen is the ballot committee, the names, usually there's a name of five people that came forward. It would be up to that ballot committee. And I believe they would probably name the vice presidential candidate. In the Green Party, they were nominated by convention. It would be up to the state central committee. I can't speak to other states.
Well, the other complicating factor to think about in terms of presidential elections is you're not actually casting a vote for that president. You are casting a vote for a slate of electors. And those electors have different degrees of how much they are bound or unbound depending upon state law, and so they could decide it within their process or their party's process to substitute somebody who had been put forth by the party. The litigation on this would make, you know, Bush v. Gore look like a no-brainer, tame situation. So I think it would be a huge mess, but it's particularly complicated by the fact that it's the Electoral College electors that we are voting for.
And if by any chance third-party candidate got enough votes to prevent either of the major party candidates from getting a majority, it goes to the House of Representatives, which would mean Trump would be the president.
Right.
I think that's almost certain. And then finally, the House of Representatives is controlled by the Republicans. They're not going to vote for
it.
Summer.
It would be decided before the new House is seated. It would be Trump. And I also wanted to say the film festival is the United Nations Association Film Festival, just to cheer you up a bit.
Recall that the vote would be by state. Yes.
Okay, just a couple of quick comments. One was about the observers and the use of cell phones and taking notes. I know that that was a problem with many counties in California, and I agree as an attorney, that's ridiculous. These are public employees. This is a public process. People should definitely be allowed to take notes. You are allowed to take notes. You are allowed to ask questions. Don't take this garbage from these election officials, no matter what they tell you. You're allowed to do this. You're not required to just steal And the last thing I want to say is just as a voter of color, a person of color in this room, I think there could have been some better outreach to voters of color. I think at the very beginning, a lot of this slim majority movement, there's a lot of blame shifting. I think there were some dubious election polls, and I think that people didn't do a lot of outreach to voters of color and sort of assumed, well, you know, we're not ballots. Okay, well, now that we realize there's been a lot of voter disenfranchisement, that's been happening to voters of color for ever.
True.
Right? All right? Yeah. Welcome to the club. We all right? So let's join together. We're all allies. We're all in this together. It is wrong, no matter who it happens to. We have to fight this.
All right. Thank you for the comment. And well spoken. Go ahead.
There was sort of a lot of information
sort of very intimidating, also with different information. So I think it's really important to really educate people and kind of do it in a succinct sort of way. So I'm wondering if you guys know of any resources you could use that sort of maybe one page saying to everyone, hey, this is the issues, these are the topics, and you know, if you'd like to get involved, talk to me more, but at least they sort of know.
Yeah. You're asking. All right. Progressive Democrats of America has an election integrity issues team, and we have a call once a month. And people from various states bring up the issues in their state and talk about what they're going to do. John Brakey has this. I met him through that process, and that's one way, because you can say, I'm here, I want to know how to do this. And Beth Harris's Black Box Voting has a handbook, so this is an observer's handbook, but it's general and national, and it, you know, now it goes right down to your state and county. And those are two resources I can suggest, and this has always been, you're not alone. This has been a step up yourself, do it yourself deal. And everybody in this room somehow did something by themselves. And the more they learned, they went, oh my God, now we all knew each other by email. We're excited to be with each other because we know each other's work. But it all started because we stepped up and did something. So thank you for being here. Those are two resources. People, the Progressive Democrats of America, our phone call, just sign up for the call and then you'll be on it.
PBAmerica.org, join.
FreePress.org, TrustVote.org, VerifiedVoting.org,
CommonCause.org, Brighton Center, Devos, Advancement Project, Verified Voting, we get that one out there. There's not just one pager. There are dozens of websites, and you know, I wish we could boil it down like that too. There's so many different facets of this problem, and I think it's fine for different people to focus on different pieces of that are most compelling to them, and I just thank you for being here and getting involved.
Yeah. And numerous videos, again, adding the vote of writing the murder spies voting lies. And, you know, there's a ton of them out there. And again, Jim Hedlund and Mary Beth Brannan are here, the great videographers of the movement. It's good to see them. And the last question is to my good friend, Dr. Goldenwald.
Well, I didn't think we'd have to do this again, but who am I to, of course, we'll have to do it again. I mean, we did this in 2005, and Mary Beth and Jim video recorded that entire thing, Lecture Running 101, which you can find online. Right? So that's the original teaching that we did. I want to start by saying I really appreciate everybody who's come and spoken. You know, I got involved in 2004. I think I'm the oldest guy in the room, 75. You know. So it seems to me that, you know, looking back on this last 16 years when we started with Bush versus Gore, one of the key things we need to be doing is to figure out how do we insinuate this election integrity movement into the bigger social movements that are in this country. And I think we've been a failure at that in some major way. Though this year, the election itself, the primaries itself, have awakened a whole new generation of people saying, what the hell just happened? Right? So I don't think we can, and we also know we are at a tipping point in our democracy. We're just this close to no longer having anything. So it's no longer enough to play by the rules, is what I'm going to say right now. That we've got to go beyond what Bill Simpson said yesterday. We need to be ready to engage in civil disobedience. We need to challenge voter registrars up and down the state and across the country. And if they throw us out or arrest us because we want to observe exactly what they're doing, well, so be it. But we need to be part of the larger social movement. Because if we're off in our own silo, and I've been screaming about this for decades, we cannot have 300 single issue groups that are are each doing their own issue. And the one thing that Bernie did for all of us is to say, hey, we are all in one big social political movement. And we need to hold on to that. We need to not refragment. And we need to not just be willing to sit in, we need to soothe their asses. And we need to also continue the legislative effort that the Voting Rights Task Force has done. And we need to have a strong legal team across this country that's willing to take this on. I mean, Bob has been a hero for doing this since 2000. He really has, because I gotta tell you, the night of the 2004 election, I was up until 4 a.m. watching live feeds that Michael Moore had created by putting 13 video teams across election places in Ohio, and I watched that and I said, they're stealing this election. And it was within a matter, well, then I was part of a national election challenging this, and I have to tell you, the mainstream media, just a bit of history, they would not cover this issue at all. More enforcement speak to this ad nauseum because we were both involved. And we had proof that they had stolen the election, not just in Ohio. We had a forensic person in New Mexico absolutely documented what had happened. So my message to all of you and to everybody online is build the movement and spread this movement into the larger social movements. Thank you.
All right. And let's thank our panel. Maybe Laura, Kelly, Barbara. Okay. It's my turn to wrap up. Let me just make a suggestion. Many of you were in the Bernie campaign, right? Let's remember what you did. In another life, I was a political theorist. I wrote about American exceptionalism, the fact that America had no mass democratic left movement of social democracy, democratic socialism. You people, you Bernie maniacs, in a short period of time, have elevated us to the rest of the world. Instead of having two large corporate capitalist party, we have a mass left movement from the bottom up. But in order for it to survive, I hate to tell you this, but many of you gotta run for office. Right? You need to. I like to think I'm speaking to the future registrars of America, the future registrars of California, the future city council people of California, the county commissioner, and the prosecutors. You can do it. How do I know? I'm doing it. I'm running for prosecutor. Tens of thousands of votes. I'm in that area. I'm running in the Capitol. He should be arrested.
Right.
Let's enforce the election laws. Yeah. Let's all run for office. Bad people, be their IT support. Go forward. Reclaim America. You can do it. You already give us thank you.
I'll do this.
So Eric, do a selfie on live stream so I can point you out. This gentleman who I'm looking at is the creator of BallotsForBernie.org. Yeah. So now you get to talk to me. So hey, wasn't this a wonderful day? Trustvote.org, Lori Grace has put a link.
link there where you can get a bunch of resources. And Lori, will you update that so all these links that people ask for can be on there?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And I'm going to challenge Lori to help us reach out to communities of people of color and help diversify this crowd. Right? So, don't forget, this conference costs us a bit of a money, and we'd love you to donate $5, $10 if you can at gofundme.com/takebackthevote. Please chip in anything you can. And also don't forget to donate to trustvote.org because they make these election court cases happen, and they also bring all these election experts to talk and to learn and educate about us, how to get involved. So they're an important group, and we can't wait to be more involved with trustvote.org. Okay. So, don't forget to join Ballots for Bernie on Facebook and like our page and request to join the closed group because we're going to open that up to the rest of America. And thank you for watching at home. Thank you all of you for coming from far away and close by. Summer Rose, thanks for live streaming. And all the volunteers that came and helped today, you were watching, helping, getting a lot of things for us, so thank you. Thank you so much. And we love Lori Grace here. Thank you, Bob. Thank you so much. Good night, these folks. Bye, America. Bye.
Yeah. So on my part.